Good morning. I think that was loud enough. My name is David Graycheck. I'm the pastor of the church. So delighted you could be with us today. We do have several announcements that I want to draw your attention to. In the bulletin, there's one mistake, so I want to make sure you see that. That is our Thursday night group that gets together for Bible study. We are going to get together on Wednesday night, and we're going to get together here in the sanctuary for an Ash Wednesday service. There will be a homeowners association meeting that will be taking place in the fellowship hall, so we will meet in here. There will not be a Bible study then on Thursday. I just want to make sure that's clear. We have it in the bulletin a little bit inaccurate. Ladies, we have the Presbyterian women this Wednesday at 10. So that hasn't changed at all. That'll still be in the fellowship hall. Also, we have coming up on the 20th of March, we have a congregational meeting that is scheduled. You normally have that sometime the end of January or so. We do have a budget that we will provide for you so you have the ability to see some of the changes that will be taking place and some of the things that we will be dealing with. One of those is Yoon won't be with us today or after today. Today is Yoon's last day with us, and the budget will reflect changes along those lines. It's the times that we live in, the things that we have to deal with today, and so we will get together on the 20th. There will be a couple things we need to vote about, so we'll make sure that you get more notice about that. Judy, you have a couple words?
Yes.
Do we have a microphone, Rachel?
Can you all hear me? Yes, you can. I do have a big voice. I just want to add one little note as to what he said about the budget. The cuts in the budget it will reflect, and not all of us are happy about it, but they are necessary. But what I want to talk about is the mats for the homeless. Not mats, but mats. I want to make that clear, because last time I wasn't very clear about it. What we do, and we are collecting plastic bags used to keep them from the landfill. And what we do is we take them and we flatten them out, we cut them into strips, and then we make yarn. And this is the yarn that we use to make the mats. This is all rolled up. I thought I could undo it. But and it's what the homeless sleep on. It protects them from the elements of the ground. And so we're very excited. We have our first, or actually our second, let me get my notes. Our second get-together will be Tuesday, March 1st at 3 o'clock. And Glenda will teach us how to make the mats, or the bags flat, how to fold them, and how to cut them, and then also how to put them together. So if you're not a crocheter, please, we need your help. Because once they start crocheting, they don't like to stop and have to flatten out a bag and extend the yarn. So we do need your help. And there is a box in the narthex that you can bring your bags and drop them off there, or during the week you can take them to the office. So again, that's Tuesday, March 1st at 3 o'clock. And this will be our second meeting, and I'm sure we'll have many more to follow. So thank you.
For those of you who are at home, that's for you, Mom. We also want you to know that the folks that are here in the service have this insert into the bulletin that they have received. There's a concert this afternoon at the Presbyterian Church in Jensen, back up, the Methodist Church in Jensen Beach. On the back is a great, where did he go? Richard, there he is. It is a great map. Very, very helpful to find it. It is at the Trinity United Methodist Church in Jensen Beach. For those of you at home, it's at 3 o'clock today. I would invite you to, or encourage you to get there a little bit early. 60, 70 different voices singing. It's remarkable from what I've been told. And so want you to know about that. That is available for all. And if you have the ability to get there, boy, don't miss that at all. So with that, let's enter into worship. Let's all stand up and sing praise and give thanks to our loving God.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks.
Loving God, there are so many things that we do not know. There are so many things that we did not give permission to in our lives. We did not give permission to a pandemic. We did not give permission for a country to invade another country. We did not give permission for you to be taken from us because of a budget. But Lord, we look to you. We don't always understand, but you offer us the gift of faith. You promise us that by faith we can receive your mercy. Lord, we thank you for that mercy, for the hunger for righteousness, for forgiveness, for you providing for all our needs and loving us so much. We thank you, Lord, that you are there for us even when the things that we don't give permission to enter our lives come anyway. There you are for us. Almighty God, though, for the good of the world, for the great things, small things, beautiful and awesome, for unforeseen splendors, we give thanks this morning. For human life, for talking and moving and thinking together, for common hopes and hardships shared from birth until dying, we thank you, God. For work to do and strength to work, for comradeship and labor, for exchanges of good humor and encouragement, we're thankful, God. For marriage, for the mystery of joy made flesh in one. For mutual forgiveness and burden shared, for secrets kept in love, we love, we thank you, God. For our family, for living and eating together, for family amusements, for family time spent at Disney, we thank you, God. For our children, for their energy, their curiosity, their drive to run a half marathon. Oh, I thank you for my daughter, God. For growing up and growing old, for rest and leisure, for time made precious by its passing, we thank you. For the church into which we have been called, for the good news we receive by word and sacrament, for our life together in the Lord, we do praise you, God. For your Holy Spirit who guides our steps and brings us gifts of faith and love, who prays in us and prompts us in our grateful worship, we praise you, God. Above all, O God, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who lived and died and lives again for our salvation, for our hope in him, for Ukraine's life in him, and for the joy of serving him, we thank you and praise you, eternal God, for all your goodness. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. My friends, let us continue singing, May Jesus Christ Be Praised.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. 1st scripture reading this morning comes from 1st John. Oh, she's in the other room. I was going to say, not John, John. You'll know what I'm talking about if you're in our Bible study, wouldn't you? I'm going to read a few verses before, but our main focus is verse 10. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. Everyone who commits sin is a child of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The Son of God was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. Those who have been born of God do not sin because God's seed abides in them. They cannot sin because they have been born of God. The children of God and the children of the devil are revealed in this way. All who do not do what is right are not from God, nor are those who do not love their brothers and sisters. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As the elders come forward this morning to receive this morning's offering, I would ask that you continue to pray for our brothers and sisters, for everyone in Ukraine, and also that this invasion not turn into something it doesn't need to, not turn into an all-out World War III. So please pray for our offering, that it helps us to touch the lives of those that God would call upon us. Please give.
You.
Loving God, we dedicate our lives to you. Please accept these gifts of our tithes and additional offerings as us giving back to you what we know first came from you. But loving God, more than anything, please accept the gift of our lives as the greatest gift we can give. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Continue on in the book of 1 Corinthians. Today we're at the end of 1 Corinthians 11, verses 17 through 33. It's a good thing when we're on the same page. There we go. Let me read for us. If I get my eyes to focus. Now in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For to begin with, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. Instead, there have to be factions among you, for only so will it become clear who among you are genuine. When you come together, it is not really to eat the Lord's Supper. For when the time comes to eat, and each of you goes ahead with your own supper, and one goes hungry and another becomes drunk, what? Do you not have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you show contempt for the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What should I say to you? Should I commend you in this manner? I do not commend you. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night from which he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, this is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup is in an unworthy manner will be answerable for the body and blood of the Lord. Examine yourselves and only eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For all who eat and drink without discerning the body eat and drink judgment against themselves. For this reason, many are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If you are hungry, eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for your condemnation. About the other things, I will give instructions when I come. Friends, the grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord stands forever. Let's pray together. Loving God, we thank you for your word. We ask that you open our eyes and open our ears that we might clearly hear, clearly see what you would have us learn from this text. Lord, this morning, open our hearts and make yourself a home. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I read that text, I realize that some might be thinking, David, why don't we do that text next week? Next week we celebrate communion. Well, there's a reason then. Because this text and Paul is suggesting we need to think about how we receive communion. What do I mean by that? Well, let's talk about that. Read a quote, couldn't find the author, so I don't know to give attribution to. It says, when you take things for granted, the things you are granted get taken. I thought about that quite a bit. I thought about that life quite a bit, and I thought about it in a way that I don't want to let what life just pass me by. I don't want you to worry about that either or do that either. Open your eyes to what is around you. You are here at this moment alive, doing well, worshiping freely. I would bet that our friends in Ukraine would want to be doing the same thing this morning. But are we taking things for granted? If you've thought of a couple things, maybe it's time to change that. I was thinking about this. It's kind of like the Wizard of Oz. Remember when Dorothy was told at the end by Glinda, the Good Witch, that she had it within her all along to get back to Kansas? Right? Do you remember that part? I mean, we all do. We've all seen it at least as many times as we are old, right? So for me, I've seen it 59 times, I'll bet. But it's irritating. She went through an awful lot. Dorothy went through all kinds of things that she didn't want to go through. She had to deal with those creepy flying monkeys. I mean, come on. She had to go get the slippers. She had to do all these. And I can't go through it all. But to know that she had it within her all along, what's with that? I think gratitude is the gift that keeps on giving when we can understand such things and not have to go through the trials to get there. We have it within us to deal with the changes that are going on in our lives right now. That, like I prayed earlier, not that we want to, but we do. Yet taking things for granted, it takes away our joy. You lose power. You lose purpose when you take something for granted. You don't stop to smell the roses anymore. You don't even look at them. I don't want to look at the roses that we provided for you today because it reminds me of the day. But you end up letting go of the little things, and everything else goes with it. When you experience gratitude and joy, though, I'm convinced that that's how we can flourish. I'm convinced that you find yourself, you know who you are, you know what you're about, you let yourself breathe in between the weight that we feel on a regular basis. You learn to let go and appreciate the good rather than hold on to the things that are upsetting you or making you sad. And all of this is within reach. Like Dorothy, all of this is within you. It's easy to allow something to be so important and become familiar. And when it's familiar, that's when we take it for granted. We lose out on the joy that it brings to our lives. This, I believe, is where Paul was coming from with communion. Next week, we will have at the end of the service, there will be stacks of trays in the back. A communion trays that we need to clean out. There will be in the rows in front of you where people will have put their cups. We have to clean that out. That'll become second nature for us, something to do. My friend will get everything together and prepare it for us ahead of time. It can become second nature, familiar. Paul is suggesting here that it appears that this church was doing exactly that in Corinth. Their familiarity with the celebration bred a subtle form of contempt. Paul gives a sobering indictment to the church. I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. It's a sobering reminder that we can go through our religious routines and actually turn against what the Lord is teaching us, instead of towards it. As we look at the first few verses in our text this morning, Paul says that he had heard that there were divisions. We've talked about that. Divisions that Corinth was dealing with. He's talked about all kinds of different things that are going on in the church in Corinth. Paul adds that the division has a tendency to reveal true believers and expose those who maybe are pretenders. Tough indictment, isn't it? In times of division, people show their true colors and their true depth of their commitment by what they suggest is important to them. However, the division that Paul is concerned about here, there's something more blatant and more disturbing is what he is teaching us. The early church had developed a practice of what they called the love feast. Before the worship, and it was a celebration of communion that was about to happen. It was intended to be something like a potluck dinner. People would bring food in, and everyone brought a dish. It was a symbol of caring in the church. It was an interesting celebration. They also were drinking wine before church. That's not such a good idea, I don't think. We meet in the morning. I don't think it says they met in the morning. But they turned it into something that it wasn't meant to be. They were fracturing the church and hurting the witness of the congregation because more affluent people apparently arrived early and ate and drank till they were full. And by the time some were arriving last minute, maybe showing up a little bit later because they really didn't have anything to bring, there was nothing available. There was a gluttonous party of those who could afford it and nothing left for those who couldn't. The poorer members, they sat around waiting then for the Lord's Supper. And Paul is suggesting, you're messing it up. You're messing up what we're to learn from this. I mean, as we talk about this morning, the Presbyterian Church has two sacraments, baptism and the Lord's Supper. Two things that we think represent who we are as Christians. But you know, the way that this was abused in Corinth, you could probably take that just about any practice that happens in the Presbyterian and any church. So as you think of this, you can also think of other things that happen, maybe as singing praise, maybe whatever it may be, where it's being abused in certain ways and not turn out the way it's supposed to be. So I'll leave that for you. Let's take a look back. The Lord's Supper is designed to remind us of what Jesus did for our past. Our past is important. We've talked about that. Our past is informative of the present. But our past is not meant to be lived in. We're reminded of Jesus' willing sacrifice as a payment for our sin. We're reminded that we are sinners who have had a hard debt paid in full by our gracious and redeeming, loving God. As one theologian has said, the world drinks to forget, Christians drink to remember. That's what understanding the past has to do with our understanding of communion. It also has a parallel. The Hebrews were given a celebration of Passover as a way to remember God's deliverance from their slavery in Egypt. You know, slavery is considered to be a part of every Christian life. I don't know if you realize that. We are enslaved to our favorite sin. I know you don't like to hear that, but our sin that we happen to repeat, we repeat it because we like it, we're enslaved to it. We can't break ourselves from it, which is why we need a Savior, which is why we need Jesus. Not making any indictments here. I'm just saying there's a good reason, and I'm grateful for you that you chose Christ as your Savior. We need it. So the Hebrews then were celebrating a Passover because they were released from their slavery of Egypt. We celebrate Easter because we are released from our slavery to sin. Each year, they rehearsed the events of the Exodus as a reminder that they were God's specially chosen people. We have the same thing, right? To remind us that we are Jesus' brothers and sisters, God's children. It's not an accident the Last Supper was this Passover meal and helping us to understand the importance of it, everything that is behind it. But the second is, the celebration of communion points to the present reality. It points to the past, sure, we learn from it, but it points to the present reality. We call the Lord's Supper, we call it communion because it's a time when we meet and encounter and come together with the Lord in a special way. If you join us next week, you'll hear me suggest that we join with our brothers and sisters around the world that maybe we've never met. Jesus said the cup represented the new covenant by his blood. It's a big deal. We used to be enemies of God because we couldn't perfectly keep God's law. We were enemies of God, and the blood made us right with God. Now we are God's children, friends of Creator of the world. We used to be alienated. Now we come close because of this meal. In the Lord's Supper, we're also reminded of our communion with one another. As I mentioned, when we come together, it's a time when the poor beggar and the powerful king bow together in the same place. We're all recipients of a mercy and a grace we did nothing to deserve, but we received together anyway. All the barriers, all the labels, all that divide us, all that divides the church, all that Paul had talked about, the problems that were going on in Corinth, are erased by this understanding of what Christ did for us. In other words, the things that we find so important that create such discord is erased for us. Every time we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we testify the message of the gospel. We testify the reason that Jesus came in the first place. Communion is meant to be a drama of sorts. It's to help us to understand, to own, to live into. It's an object lesson that communicates in a different and powerful way. A person who did not speak English could join for worship and understand what we're doing when we go through the drama of communion. They could understand what's going on if they don't understand the words. Unbelievers may understand theologically what we're doing, but they can see. They can see this is how we're willing to live our lives. We're willing to understand this is what the gospel does for us when we renew our commitment. Seems odd, doesn't it, that the Lord's Supper can actually be a point of conflict, though, for Christians? Sad that the church can become so divided over something that was meant to bring us together. We're good at that. I believe it's valuable to talk about the differences in order to understand where each of us is coming from. Neither Jesus nor Paul gave instructions or mechanics or regulations as to how communion was supposed to be done. We're just shown what it means. And so part of me understands that as we apply our meaning to that, we can approach it with reverence. And this is what it means to me. This is what it means to us. Paul gave the Corinthians a sober warning. That's some wise counsel. The warning was this. Hear Paul's words in verses 29 through 32. Whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup is in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves, we could not come under judgment. When we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world. Paul is saying here that we can go through motions in our life and do all the things that a Christian does to do the right thing and miss it completely. Miss completely the opportunity that gives us to change our lives. Paul says that those who do not participate in the Lord's Supper in respectful and God-honoring fashion will face God's judgment because they are sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. He seems to say that in the church we are sick and had died because of the callous approach of this celebration. We had missed the point completely. Oh, I don't want to be like that church in Corinth. But it gives us solid advice, solid counsel. One of the reasons we take our time during communion is to encourage people to examine themselves It's a time where you get to go through and physically examine where you are. We should examine ourselves and see where we are in our faith. The communion is a celebration for believers. As you hear me say, those who are in Christ. That's who the communion, that's who the table is for. It's for those who have recognized their sin and have come to Christ only because they are in need of forgiveness. If you haven't come to that point in your life, of course there's no need. But you should either understand that it is a step of faith or it is a first step. That's why we come to this. That's why it's a big deal. We should examine our hearts and where our hearts are with these things. Like you, I want to try and get it right in my life. But I recognize how I don't. I do. I pay attention to things that get me sideways. I understand my communion with the Lord. I understand my communion with others also. I had someone explain the cross that way to me. That it's a way of our relationship with the Lord and our relationship to one another. The cross. We should examine our hearts to come to the table while cherishing something else is really making a tremendous mistake. We were never meant to live a life where we cherish something other than the living God in our heart at the same time as cherishing our Lord. Our Lord is a jealous God. We're never meant to be that way. It's important to point out that being unworthy to take communion and taking communion in an unworthy manner is something that Paul said, this is not a good thing. We're all unworthy, which is why we check our hearts when we come to this. If you're not truly prepared, they have a meal at Denny's, for crying out loud. It's that big a deal. So what are some conclusions that I can draw from this? Some general principles that we can live out in our lives? First is our approach to the worship of the Lord is an indicator of our regard for the Lord. Does that make sense? I want to say that again. How we approach the worship of the living God is an indicator of our regard for the Creator of the world. When we approach an act of worship, it is a service to the Lord. If we do so in a disrespectful way, it shows how we feel about our loving God. Our treatment of others is also a barometer of our love for the Lord. The reason for this entire discourse is the fact that the Corinthians were making a mockery of the sacrament by their disregard for each other during this love feast. What a weird name. Jesus said we show our love for him by the way we treat the least of our brothers and sisters. When we ignore the hungry, the imprisoned, the thirsty, we're turning our backs on God. In 1 John, we read again, not John, but 1 John. We're told this is how we who the children of God are and who the children of the devil are, anyone who does not do what is right is not a child of God. What is right? Well, it's not my opinion. It's not yours. It's right in the eyes of the Lord only. We need to ask ourselves, are we guilty of dismissing someone as unimportant in our lives? Are we ignoring the needs of those around us, the community around us? Are we disrespecting someone with our words and our attitudes? Are we treating someone unfairly? If so, we're not only the problem, we have a problem with that person, but we have a problem with our relationship with God as well. Because we're not living into what we're asked to do. It's easy. It's easy to slip into a mindless routine of the familiar. But many times, I believe, when we check that familiar, we'll find that we're practicing something that even we don't believe. We must fight the tendency to just go with the familiar because it's what we've always done. We must continually work these views and disciplines with freshness, with wholeheartedness. We step into a world that is unknown. This church doesn't know what the world is going to be like in the coming year. This church is a group of people. Nobody knows. We step into a budget we never planned, but we have to do. We step into a world that my hopes is, I pray to God, is considered post-pandemic. Is considered free from invasion, from nuclear war, from anything hostile. But we don't know. We don't know. Familiar taught us something. Familiar doesn't necessarily guide us. Loving God does. Because if we don't approach our future with wholeheartedness in what God is teaching us, well, our meetings are just a resurrection of the past. And it has nothing to do with God in the moment, in the present, and in the future. I'm excited about that future, but it'll be different. Let's pray together. Loving God, I don't like to think about different, let alone preach it. I don't like to think about things that are harmful versus good. You've given me the ability to check my heart so that as I step into a world of unknown, I am wholly yours in whatever given moment. Lord, I pray that for all of my brothers and sisters here with me within the sound of my voice, that we commit ourselves to being your brothers and sisters, your children, to your guidance. Your will be done, not ours. As scary as the unknown is, Lord, we go into it knowing you've been there ahead of us. And you will be with us in the present. We live on those future promises. God, we live on the fact that you love us more than we know how to love ourselves. Help us to love ourselves enough to let go and let you. And that's the good we look for, Lord, you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, as we go and we step into this unknown future, I want to go in and I want to sing songs like Alleluia, Sing to Jesus. I want to be thinking, thank God you go before me and it isn't up to me. Because I can promise you, I know a lot of things, but I don't know what the future holds. Save for the fact that God went before us. So let's stand up. Let's sing our closing hymn. Alleluia, Sing to Jesus. Will you sing with me? There's my cell phone. I will be publishing office hours, when I'll be available. But also, I want you to make sure you have this number. If you need to reach me at any time, you can do that. If I can't answer, that only means that I'm in a meeting, and I'll get back to you. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. So, my friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the light of the Lord's countenance shine upon your face and give you peace. Go now. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And all God's children said, amen.